This is the Normandy coastline, the famous beaches where on June 6, 1944, 160,000 Allied troops landed, the biggest seaborne invasion ever staged that would ultimately lead to the defeat of Hitler's Nazi Germany. Flying in the air that day, a young Australian, Max Barry, a rear gunner with the RAF Bomber Command. They just flew on a mission over northern France to take out Nazi positions from the air and were flying back to England. That young 19-year-old Aussie was about to witness history. 80 years on, this is his story.
I was a rear gunner in a Lancaster. Our task was to bomb the German gun emplacements on the coast at Normandy. And was just keeping the Germans out of action. The main role of the Air Force at that stage was to disrupt bridges and roadways and railway lines so the Germans could be difficult to get troops forward. We'd been, bombing on the coast, and we're heading back west of Cherbourg Peninsula. And I had a marvellous view of the channel with over 5,000 ships there. Amazing. And we kept well away from that because it's a bit dangerous to fly over the top. Well, it was just part of the whole action to regain the continent, oust the Germans, and the French government in recent years, awarded this Legion of Honour to surviving veterans who were busy that day, June 6, getting the Germans out of France. Well, it was the start of the putting down the Nazi regime. We had to get onto the continent, really, to get control, because ultimately it's the man with the rifle who walks around who runs the show. Hello. As I said earlier, we were busy at that stage disrupting transport systems to make it difficult for the Germans to bring relief people and reserves and equipment forward. On June 10, 11, we'd been, our aircraft was part of an attack on a railway station at Alençon, and a bit of flak, no fighters around, but we were heading back to England, and a bit west of, or near Lyon in France. I was suddenly looking out there, and big flames, sheets of flame were coming past as close as that cabinet there. And there was a port in her engine on fire. The mid-upper gunner and myself both alerted the pilot that was also the case. And the engineer was then instructed to take action to put the fire out in that engine. But other engines started catching fire, and we started to lose height, and the pilot told the two gunners to get out of their turrets and open the back hatch door and throw out anything they could to lighten the load to reduce the loss. And we were aiming to be west of Cherbourg again, But we continued to fall, and it was became obvious that we would drop into the ocean before we got to England. So the pilot told us to bail out. The people up front, the bomb aimer, which was sitting over and was on top of the hatch, the front hatch, the navigator and the wireless operator were able to go out the front. The gunners were instructed to sit on the back hatch, mid upper first, facing backwards, fall sideways, out. He sat there and wasn't falling, so it came a shove. He was on his way. I sat there and faced backwards, tried to fall out. No, couldn't fall. I think there was centrifugal force which stopped that. And fortunately, I was a kid that grew up on a farm with post and rail fences. I realised I could get back in the aircraft, face forward, sit there, face forward, roll, so I pushed myself out and floated down in the dark. And first realised I was getting close to the ground when the tree branches went past my face. But I didn't get hurt at all. I landed and gathered up the parachute and rolled it up and pushed out of some leaves and started walking north. We had little compasses who were in our pocket, in our medals, the buttons, really. And I realised the Allies had landed 4 days before and they were just north. So I figured I could walk up, get close to the front, and wait till they pushed through. I was able to speak some French because I learned French at school. And fortunately, in Colac, there was a lady who was Swiss-born, French-speaking, French-born, and she offered the teacher at high school to take the leaving class, about six of us, for an hour's discussion once a week. So it was a Thursday afternoon, we used to go over there about 4 o'clock, 4 to 5, and we walked in the front gate, speak only French the next hour. So I was sort of familiar with the language. I could talk to the local people, get something to eat and some advice. I was able to swap most of my uniform clothing, Air Force clothing, for farm clothing. So I had sort of old baggy sort of clothing suited in, and kept the beret, and that was all right. So I could walk along the streets as long as I didn't get mixed up with the Germans. I was able to keep walking. So I got up and I could hear the gunfire up front. Figured that was close enough. And then found a little village with half a dozen houses, no Germans around. And I went to the front of the house and knocked on the door, and a lady came out and asked her to buy some food. No food. But she had milk. Good. And she brought some milk out and she said 1 litre or two. And I had no idea what a litre was, but two sounded better than one, so I took two for two and drank the lot. She was a bit surprised. We had in our escape kit French money, so I was able to pay for things. I realised she was friendly, and she realised I was an airman on the run, and suggested if I went down the lane, they had a farm just down the and if I went down there, got up in the barn, and old Barnes was there. They would leave some food outside at night, which they did. There was a horse trough outside. I was going to put tablets in an escape kit. Use the water. My first plastic bag I ever saw was that in that kit. First you could fill the bag with water, put the tablet in, wait 10 minutes, then drink it. After a week, early in the morning, the farm boy who worked there came down, told me the Germans were in the village to get out. So I grabbed my few bits and pieces, left nothing there, took off, got about three fields away, two German army people, halt! And we spoke in French. My French was better than the German at that stage. But then he said, papier, papier. And I had no papers, of course, arrested him. So he marched me up to the little town nearby, the Ferrière Harong. And there the German captain, army captain, I was fortunate they were army people. So I ran 3 or 4 k's east, SS people. They were loaded by them. So the army man asked me a few questions, realised I was an airman on the run. Had discs, of course, and I could see that. Kept me in a, locked me up for the night, and the next morning handed me over to the Luftwaffe people who were then responsible for my career movements. And the Luftwaffe sent me to Paris, you know, a small utility with equivalent to a corporal. That it, he was a guard looking for me, had his own little smizer. And there was an interrogation camp just outside Paris. The French had set it up to, so the Germans had set it up to take all the Air Force people as they came in there and interrogate them and send them on their way. So I was there interrogated by a German officer, Air Force man, Luftwaffe, spoke perfect English. So he didn't get much information from me, but I passed from rank and number. And he said, oh, you will be in the still overnight. Sleep well. We'll shoot spies in the morning. Next morning, they took me in for breakfast. And I had 3 or 4 days there. And then we were shipped off to Bankow, Luft 7 in Poland, by train. I was picked up on the 7th of July. We got to the camp probably mid-September by the time then. And initially we were in Air Force NCOs, all that camp. We were in a temporary camp, little huts, tent size, cardboard and malthoid for a roof, until mid-October, by which time the Russian prisoners had built some barracks in a compound next door, and we moved in there before winter came. It was very cold in the winter, the water dripping off the battered roof, and so on. Hang about a metre. those days I had a hair. If you watch a comb and I comb my hair, it'd all go white. Yeah. But we were alerted towards Christmas time that the Red Army was advancing and we might have to move back to Germany. And sure enough, I think it was on the 19th of January, we got word in the early morning about 4 o'clock. You got 2 hours to pack and out on the road to walk. So we grabbed whatever it would take. You had to be able to carry it or pull it. And that day we walked about 20 kilometres. Snow was about a metre deep, but we walked on and off. At some days we stayed for a day. And after a while we got to across the... we had to walk all night one night. That was a dreadful night. We did about 40 kilometres all told. But we had to cross the Oder because then they could hold the Russians back. We walked over the bridge. The German sappers were putting the charges underneath to time. Having got to the other side, we had a day or two's rest. And after some days, we were put on board a train. Those wooden-sided trains you see in the photos, about 55 of us in this particular cabin, so standing room mainly, wasn't much room, couldn't sit down or anything. We were issued with rations for 2 days and no water the first 2 days, but it was cold, so we were thirsty. And after 2 days, we were allowed to have water, but there was no more food. But then we arrived shortly after that at Luckenwalde, an old peacetime camp for political prisoners, converted into a POW camp, British, American, and sundry other people from Norway, Middle East, and so on. And it was a headquarters for some thousands of French farm workers. French POWs were doing the farm work, and they were controlled from that centre. One morning, a jeep came in to that camp, and it had two war correspondents on board. They came in to collect one of their friends who was in the camp, and took him away. They said they'd arranged for the Americans to send in trucks to take us back, because we were only about 40 miles from the American line. By late morning, word went round that the trucks which had come would not be able to take us out. The Russians apparently were sticking to the agreement that Allied prisoners would be sent home via Odessa. That was apparently agreed at Yalta when the Churchill and Roosevelt and Stalin met. However, some of our people started to walk down the road, as we knew the Americans were over there 40 miles away. You'd walk there. Three of us who had been working together, sharing food and so on, we decided to go to walk out too. And sure enough, down the road, along comes a Russian car. empty American trucks behind. The Yanks yelled out, "We can't pick you up or they would turn the lot of us." At the end of the heap, end of the convoy, another Russian car to make sure that nobody got in. The Russian said to go back to the camp. And some of our people did that. Some of us took off across country. So that night, we three stayed at a little German town, Truyn Britchen, stayed with a German family. They were pleased to have us in the house rather than the Russians. The next morning, we got out on the road, walking along. A little Russian convoy of half a dozen trucks came along, and we hitched a ride. The trick there was to put a little flag on your shoulder to show what country you're for. So we put American flags, which they recognised. They didn't know Australian, of course, but one each of three trucks. These fellas had been in the battle somewhere, they had bandages on their heads and whatever. But they took us to a place called Zerbst, which is on the Elbe. Had lots of people there milling around. People who've come from the other side, waiting to go the other way. The Americans put up a temporary floating bridge over the Elbe. We walked over to a group and saw a tank with a white star, an American. So we went up to the sergeant in charge and said, "Can we get a ride back over the side with you people?" And he said, "Who are you and what are you doing?" And we told him, he said, "Well, get one of each of these three tanks. These tanks, they're not all that happy over here. If their guns were pointing across the square and on the other side the Russian guns were pointing there, they weren't all that friendly." Sure enough, we got an hour or so later over the other side, back to their camp. And the man, sergeant in the tank said, "You fellas had anything to eat?" And we said, "No." "Oh, over the cookhouse." Said to the cook, "Yeah, these fellas haven't any, they're paired up because they haven't any food today. You got anything you'd eat?" "Oh, yes, yes. You have the great big fridge." Took out a cooked half chicken each. We scoffed a lot. We stayed with them out that night. And again, next morning, joined the chair line. Their system was to have a tray with little compartments. You walked along and people put stuff in that you're in. I came along to where the man was making flapjacks. I said, "Oh, I hope that one is on a stale."
Amazing.
40 miles away, that is. Yes. But they arranged for us to be taken to Brussels and... interesting day on the way. At one of the stops there, the Americans lined us up. They had a drum of powder, a pressure thing, and a man there had lice control, DDT. We stayed in Brussels till we got a ride back by air to England. And landed in England, was then sent down to Brighton, southern England. The Air Force had two big hotels under their control, the Metropole and the Grand. And we stayed there. Probably about the best part of the month before we could get a ride home. came back on the Orion for Panama Canal, New Zealand, landed in Sydney. And because I was a Victorian, I went by train from Sydney to Melbourne. And then I'm in camp for a short while, and I was just discharged in January 45. I'd been in a teaching position before the war, and I didn't want to go back to teaching. But out in the open country, I had in mind running a small poultry farm. In those days, you could have a poultry farm of, say, 3,000 chooks and make a living that way, and it was good. Nobody could worry about them. But you couldn't buy any materials to make sheds for those days, and it was suggested I should take up the offer of the Commonwealth Reconstruction Training Scheme to go to university. And I decided to study vet science. And that meant I could work in the open. But to study vet science at that stage, the only complete course that was available was in Sydney. Other places had first year only. There's 5-year course in those days. Queensland had a four-year course. The final year came to Sydney also. I offered to go to Sydney straight away instead of going to Melbourne. Then took me up to Sydney. And the young lady up there, she sits behind me. In 85, Christina, her younger daughter, had married an Englishman, and Ruth and I decided to get a trip to Europe to a tour and then call and see them. So we did a trip around Scandinavia. I think it was... Yes, that was a trip in Europe now. And I said to son-in-law, who spoke French quite well, I'd like to go over to Normandy so we could find those people who were so helpful to me and thank them, because they ran a great risk, you see, if they'd been caught giving food to me. Well, but no problem. He said, we'll go over on a weekend. So we flew over to Le Havre, hired a neighbour's car, drove down to the town, the ferry Orang. I bought Michelin map. Michelin maps are very detailed. Every little place is there. I found this little town, and we drove down, had lunch on the way, and then into this town, saw a lady doing gardening at the front, and spoke to her and said what was about. She wasn't very interested, but lady across the street heard these strange voices, and she was quite interested. She came over, and then she took us for about 2 hours around here. We found the farm where I'd been hiding. I said to the current owner, had demolished the old house and replaced it. I said to him, I suppose the farmer and his wife have passed on. He said, oh, no, they retired just recently and they're living in a village about 10 k's away. So we drove over to the village, went on the door, and they were amazed to suddenly see that, well, after all 45 years. We had a couple of drinks and exchanged names and addresses. We've been in touch ever since. I've been to that farm saw the son and the daughters. The older people had three daughters, two of them are still alive, were then, and are still alive now. And one was married. I've been back to that farm three or four times. They've retired off the farms now. They've moved into the town, into an apartment in town. It's sensible. We now correspond by email. The younger daughter, Madame Janine, speaks good English as well as French. I said to her one day when we were walking in, why don't we just talk in French, in English? She said, no, in France, we talk in French. But we correspond in English. Now it's a matter of postcards or emails at Christmas time or probably next month. From the day I'll send an email, and it'll be a big day there. Well, I suppose it sets an example of what can be done to try and retain the lifestyle that we have. It would certainly have been a different lifestyle if the Nazi people had taken over. Oh, yes, I suppose so. It was all part of an effort. Unfortunately, a lot of young fellows were killed. There were over 50,000 air crew people killed. The sad thing from a community point of view is that most of those young people in Bomber Command would have been able to contribute quite a lot to the community had they lived on. Because they were capable of learning and doing things. Napoleon said at some stage he likes his generals to be lucky. Well, you have to be lucky in war. Wrong place, wrong time. Not.
See, Mark.
I'll give an example. On the way from France to Paris, this young Air Force lad guarding me, we stopped at a timbered area for a break. And an SS tank group came in, parked alongside. One of the SS tank people came over, saw me, scruffy looking fellow, and talked with the Air Force man. And he offered to take me out of the tree and shoot me. The Luftwaffe man wasn't having part of that. No, his instruction was to take me to X. He'd be in trouble if I didn't get there. They had an argument, shouting at each other. And the Luftwaffe bloke, well, he smiled out and cocked it. Tank man took off. There was no love lost between some of the other service people and the SS.